hope has changed tremendously since the first film. Like, I feel sometimes like I get whiplash trying to keep up with how quickly her life changes and evolves. When we first met her in the first Ant-Man film, she was a corporate woman who was completely dedicated to her work, had no intimate relationships to be spoken of in her life, was estranged from her father, was, you know, had believed her mother was dead, and was in no romantic relationship. Cut to like 4 or 5 hours of cinema later, two films later, at the beginning of Quantumania, she has repaired her relationship with her father. She has recovered her mother from the quantum realm. She has fallen in love with Scott Lang, and now she's stepmomming little Cassie Lang, who's a young woman. And her life is just totally transformed. Her life is full of love. It's full of intimacy and connection and vulnerability. And all of that peace and contentment that comes from that is just pouring out into her work, which she has now dedicated her company, PIM Technologies, to solving the largest problems of the world, like global warming or the housing crisis. So she is a renewed woman. She is a very different person than when I first started playing her. Well, I'm not easily impressed in real life, and neither is Hope. I am a little bit cynical, and so is Hope. But I'm very soft on the inside, despite having a somewhat harder exterior, like a tough, not hard, but a tougher exterior. And I think that what was fun and surprising to play with Hope was to reveal to the audience that inside there's this really tender, loving, caring woman. So, you know, I think we share those qualities. I don't know all of the ways that Hope is using the PIM technology for humanitarian efforts, but I do know that one of the things that we talked about when conceiving these and sort of trying to establish who she is now and what she's up to was that she was creating tiny little communities so that we could deal with both the housing crisis and global warming. Because if our homes take up less land, if our homes take up less energy, if people take up less land and energy, then ultimately there's more to go around. You know, one BlackBerry could feed an entire community for breakfast. And so that's one of the ways that I know that Hope has been using PIM Tech to try to make the world a better place. Well, I think when Hope lost her mommy when she was 8 years old, she harbored all of these fantasies that mom was coming back and what that would be like for her. And I think she really believed that there would be this idealistic, perfect reunion where they would become best friends and they would tell each other everything. And, you know, when she went through her teen life, I'm sure there were still fantasies of like, oh, if I had a boyfriend, I could talk to my mom about it, but I just have this crazy old man who likes ants to talk to about it. And so she harbored idealistic ideas. And then when Janet actually came back, she had severe PTSD from the quantum realm and all of the things she experienced there. And she doesn't feel that she can share that with her family. And so Hope is feeling really shut out by her mom. Janet is keeping secrets from them all. And it's really painful for Hope. And the way Hope deals with her pain is she is notorious for just being pissed. She just gets mad because she's not very good with dealing with her pain. So she's really angry. She's angry and she feels really, really disappointed that this reunion with Janet isn't all the things she hoped it would be. Well, you know, harking back to what I was talking about with Janet and Hope, in this disappointment that she doesn't have the intimacy that she hoped to have with her mother, she doesn't have the friendship that she hoped to have where Janet trusts her with her stories and with her life and with her secrets. I think there's a translation to how Hope relates to Cassie, and she doesn't keep anything from Cassie. She didn't change her diapers. She didn't, you know, wipe snot from her nose. She doesn't have that kind of relationship with Cassie. She just sees this brilliant, capable, really cool young woman who she sees no reason to not trust her and not believe in her capabilities. And so she really treats her as an equal and treats her very much as an adult. And I think she's somewhat baffled by the fact that Scott doesn't, and that Scott can't seem to see Cassie as the incredible young woman or the capable young woman that she has become. And I do think that there's some level of like knee-jerk reaction to the disappointment she feels in her relationship with Janet and be like, I'm not gonna do that to Cassie. I'm gonna make it different for her. So the Pym, Lang, Van Dyne family end up in the quantum realm because Hank and Hope have been toying with new quantum technology with Cassie. Cassie has grown up in this incredible family of scientists. She's very curious. She's been doing her own experimentation. And Hank and Hope have really encouraged it. They've seen no reason not to. And unfortunately, she's created a Hubble telescope type two-way radio with the quantum realm. And she turns it on in Hank's lab in the basement. And when she does so, Janet freaks out, knowing that that's a very bad idea because there's something down there we don't all know about. And she rips it out of the wall and eliminates the connection to the quantum realm. But nonetheless, some other energy force comes back through this two-way radio and enters the room and starts sucking the entire room, including the family, down into the quantum realm with it. I think the signature of an Ant-Man film is, first of all, family first. It's all about family dynamics and family stories. It's also about humor and lightness and sweetness. And in a big, sweeping, epic Marvel tale like the one that we're telling, with very, very high stakes and a very formidable bad guy, a very formidable villain, somehow Peyton still managed to hang on to the film being essentially about family, being essentially sweet and always funny. I would describe the quantum realm as the opening of new possibilities. So we have the multiverse already, and essentially there is no distinction between the difference between a universe that is out there versus a universe that is in here or in there or around us. So there's just this infinitude of possibility that if you go into the quantum realm, any which direction, and direction doesn't exist really in that space, but in our concepts, in any which direction, in any which way, you can encounter something never before conceived of. It could be a void, it could be a vacuum, it could be a dense space that is completely claustrophobic that life can't exist in. It could be literally anything. So once you open up one space, which is in the quantum realm, you've opened up every possibility for the Marvel Cinematic Universe to go wherever they want, whenever they want, however they want.